Okay, in this video, I want to talk a little bit about inverse functions in the context of our trig definitions. All right, but let's first remember the definition from algebra of inverse functions. Let's say we had f and we wanted to compose that with f inverse. When you compose inverse functions, remember you get out x. They sort of cancel each other, and that's going to occur both ways. So f inverse of f of x is also going to be equal to x over the over their common domain anyways. All right, so for example, in algebra, we might have something like f of x equal to the squaring function, and then its inverse we found to be the square root of x. All right, so looking at these two functions, when I do f composed with f inverse, I want to look at f first, which is the squaring function, in which I'm going to plug in the f inverse. So f composed with f inverse is actually equal to square root of x squared. Now over the domain where, in this case, let's just consider positive numbers only. Over that domain, when you square a square root, you just get out the argument there, x. They sort of cancel, right? And then when I do it the other way, f inverse of f of x, in this case I would have to look at f inverse first, which I think is square root of x, and then plug in x squared. Okay, and the square root of x squared is x, right? So you could see there, sort of inverse functions sort of undo each other. Now it turns out sine, cosine, and tangent can be defined as a function. And so it does have an inverse. And we'll do more with the inverse functions later when we get to the graphing section. But for now, we know sine of 30 degrees is equal to 1/2, right? That's an absolute fact. Now, what happens if I apply that inverse function to both sides of this equation? In that case, we'd get sine inverse of sine of 30 would have to equal sine inverse of 1/2. And now, from sort of the definition of inverses, when you compose f inverse with f, you get out x, right? The argument. So sine inverse and sine, they sort of cancel, and I get out the variable there, or the angle there, which is 30 degrees. And then on this side, we're left with sine inverse of 1/2. So what this says is that sine inverse of 1/2 is actually equal to 30 degrees. Now we can test that on a calculator. To get to the inverse functions on the calculator, on my calculator, it's a toggle. So I have a sine button. If I hit it once, I get sine. If I hit it again, I'll get sine inverse. And since I am in degree mode, I'm going to type in the degree measure, 30 degrees. Since we're in degree mode, I type in the ratio, 1/2, right? Sine inverse of 1/2, and I should get 30 degrees, right? And so notice that when you use sine inverse takes in ratios, and it returns angles. So a little different than the sine button, right? The sine button takes in angles, returns ratios. Sine inverse takes in ratios and returns angles. All right. There are domain issues. We're going to talk about that later. But for now, let's do some quick examples on the calculator. Okay, here I have three examples. And I'm just going to type them into the calculator here. So this is going to be approximately equal to. All right, so hit the button twice, sine inverse, 0.1253. I get approximately 7.1987. Now this is an angle, right? You typed in a ratio, and the result is an angle. So we round angles off in this class to one decimal place. All right, so 7.2. And since I am in degree mode, I won't forget to put a little degree up there. All right, so super important. Sine inverse takes in ratios. And then for this class, we're going to be rounding ratios off to four places. And it returns angles. Okay? We round decimal degree angles off to one place. All right, let's do this next one. Cosine inverse of 0.5631. Hit enter. And so I can see my angle here now is 55.7 degrees. And I am going to use a little squirrely equal like that, approximately equal to, what did I say, 55.7 degrees. Okay, and then finally, tangent inverse. Let's do that. Tangent inverse of 1.6413. And I get approximately 58.6 degrees. Awesome. So there you go. That's how you use your inverse functions on your calculator. Okay, here I want to talk about finding the inverse of those reciprocal trig functions. All right, so in this case, I have cosecant inverse of 2.5634. Now I'm going to show you the theory first, and then I'll show you how to do it easily. So in this case, we know cosine inverse takes in a ratio, and whatever we get, it's going to be returning an angle. If we're in degree mode, that would be an angle in degrees. So at this point, what I'm going to do is apply cosecant to both sides of this equation. Applying cosecant to both sides will retain the equal. And on this side, I'd have cosecant of theta. On this side, I have cosecant of cosecant inverse, 2.5634. Okay, now remember inverse functions, when you have the function and its inverse, they sort of cancel each other. So on this side, we'll be left with 2.5634. And on the left side, we'll be left with cosecant of theta. All right, so at this point, I know cosecant of theta is 2.5634. Now, cosecant is 1 over sine. And so 1 over sine is going to be 2.5634. I don't really want sine in the denominator. So what I'm going to do, this is a little tricky. I'm going to go ahead and reciprocate both sides. So reciprocating both sides, I'll have sine of theta equals 1 over 2.5634. And then applying sine inverse to both sides, we then have theta equals sine inverse of 1 over 2.5634. And so you can see here, that's the same theta that we had at the beginning. And since we don't have a cosecant inverse button, we do have a sine inverse button. So at this point, we can actually make this calculation. All right, so on a calculator, I want to find cosecant inverse. To find cosecant inverse, I have to type in sine inverse of 1 over the value that was given. So 2.5634, right? 2.5634 is right. And then hit enter. And so in this case, I'm getting 22.96. So that 6 is going to round me up and then push everything over. So 23.0 degrees. And I will have to include that 0 to show that I did round off properly. All right, so that's the idea. To calculate the inverse like that, you do sine or cosine or tangent, whatever inverse is associated to the reciprocal function, and then you do 1 over the number. All right, so let me show you how that works. All right, so here I have three examples. First one is cosecant inverse of a ratio. And so that's going to be equal to, now cosecant is 1 over sine, so we're going to use sine inverse of 1 over the 1.4132. Okay, and then I can use my calculator. So again, we don't have a cosecant inverse button. All right, so to do cosecant inverse, we type in sine inverse of 1 over the value, so 1.4132, just like that. And this is a degree, right? I'm in degree mode, so this is a degree measure. And so we round degrees off to one place, so that would be 45.0 degrees. Okay? Now let's look at secant. Secant is 1 over cosine, so we're going to use cosine inverse, and then we'll do cosine inverse of 1 over 2.3162. So doing that on a calculator, cosine inverse 1 over, and I get approximately 64.4 degrees. Looks good. And then lastly, we're asked to find cotangent inverse, so that's equal to tangent inverse 1 over that number there, so 0.5631. And then on a calculator, tangent inverse and I get 60.6 degrees. All right, and so there you go. That's how you find the inverse of those reciprocal functions on a calculator. And so there you have it. Good luck.